Assalamualaikum.
Assalamualaikum and very good afternoon to everyone. Okay, welcome to OCT 521. This course is about social, industrial and health legislation. Saya harap you all semua baik-baiklah. Subjek social industrial health and legislation ni adalah complementary to what you have learned for return to work, economic and this subject very important for OT because it involves act and legislation. As a professional profession, you need to understand the law and legislation behind the because you involve of returning the injured workers to work, so you need to understand what are the law and rules and regulation behind this course. So I think how many of you in this class? 51. 51 of you. I think more than that. And I hope you all can join. So you all semua tak duduk di kampus kan? Duduk di rumah masing-masing. Okay. Any one of you knows about this course? Semua mute dah . Semua kalau boleh letaklah gambar tu. Apa video tu supaya saya nampak muka awak siapa dia. Nanti apa dah habis course pun saya tak kenal siapa awak . So apa ni? Tetap bukalah video . And so in this course, if you read the syllabus, I already upload in the UFuture, the syllabus course. If you got, you spend your time reading the course. So in this course, it's about the act and regulation related to the worker. In terms of health legislation, in terms of industrial, and also in terms of social legislation. If you read the syllabus, I will share you in the screen about the syllabus. And whenever anyone want to join, if I not see, you just highlight to me lah. I will admit them. So if you see this course, the syllabus, where is it? So you all nampak tak course syllabus ni?
Nampak invoice.
Invoice . Okay, sekejap . So saya kena admit, ada yang you all lambat masuk . So I kena admit. Okey. Nampak tak? Okey, sekarang ni dah 55 orang you all. So this 5-1 due to the COVID situation So I got instruction from the faculty, there is no final exam. So everything is continuous continuous exam. So when you the outcome of the course is that you able to explain different acts and regulation that pertaining to the health, social and safety of the workers. This is very important. You understand the act and regulation that relate to the workers in terms of the health, social and safety. And then you are able to display teamwork skill via discussion in group on the different guideline and code of ethics that relate to the acts and regulation. And demonstrate information management skill via identifying current issues and case scenario that related to health, social and safety of the workers. So in this course, the course description is that the course introduce student the different law, legislation, code of ethics and guideline in relation to health and safety and welfare of the workers. The information gained by the student will be used to promote and rehab healthy injured workers. So you can promote regarding the guideline and also the regulation available, and also you can use that to rehab your injured workers. So whoever want to embark your career in occupation health sector, this advantage to you all because you understand the act and regulation. I want to admit, okay, this one. It's okay. Semua dah admit. Okay. Then in this act and regulation also, whatever the hazard that affect the workers will be highlighted. So when we work with the material and also chemical and also machine, there is a certain limit to human being, and in this act and regulation they stipulate to what extent the limit that can be exposed to the worker. So this is advantage for you all. You understand the act and regulation, and then you able to play role as a case manager. If you want to embark your career in as a case manager, because right now there is a opportunity. There is a demand. There is a demand for graduate OT student to work at SOSO. So you can become a case manager. So if you have this knowledge about the act and regulations, this is an advantage for you to be better in your career as a case manager. So so please immerse yourself, occupy yourself, really occupy with this course. Probably in future you become a case manager because statistic that been reported by SOXO, many injured workers that need to be taken care of, and then OT have an advantage working at that sector. So in this reverse content, we going to understand the first today lecture regarding the Malaysian law and health safety legislation. So this when we study law, we should understand how the law being developed, of the law being endorsed and etc. Eh? And then you going to understand regarding the Occupational Safety and Health Act 1994. This is very important because when workers in work at industry, they have to abide this act. So a lot of there's a act and also regulation. So I choose the act, the regulation that we need to understand, and also there is an act regarding factory and machinery, and they call it Factory and Machinery Act 1967. You should know also this act, and also there is a compensatory act, Compensation Act 1952. And Act of Pakeso, Act of So, 1969, Occupation Act 1955. So all these things we need to know, because this relate to the workers, And also the guideline and code of ethics. Some of the things not being stipulated in the regulation, but being covered in the guideline. So there is a lot of guideline that we can use. You can use when you work in a health factor, in the occupational health area. For example, guideline of standing, guideline of working, sitting, guideline gender at work, guideline of occupational noise, haze at work. So all these things are already available. We provide you the guideline. It can access through the Department of Health and Safety at Putrajaya over there, at their website. So, but along the way, along the lecture, I will give you the guideline. So for today, for this course, the method of teaching is lectures, and then I will give a problem-based learning and case study. And the assessment, there's no final exam. There's no final exam. There's no final exam. Okay, I have to admit some of your friend here, Safa, Nur Zafira. There's no final exam. There's a continuous assessment. There'll be three tests: test one, test two, and also the final test. I'll be 40%. Not final exam, so at the end of the 14 week, you're going to have a test, a final test, consists of 40%, and there is a assignment. Assignment is a group assignment. So I will highlight to you all how you're going to do your assignment. So you need to form a group. 5 to 6 person per group. Then you have to find a case, a case scenario, incident, accident happen, and then you have to, there is a task you have to do. So this is the, there is a text provided here. Along the way, I give you also the notes, the guideline, and etc. So, any one of you have question regarding this syllabus?
No,
ada soalan?
Ada.
Apa dia? Nurul, apa ada soalan? Okey, seorang pun tak ada soalan. Seorang pun faham, semua faham. Okey, saya masukkan ada seorang lagi yang sekejap terkeluar, sekejap masuk. So all together you have 57 pula. So you have to divide into, you have to form a group. Apa, 5 to 6% lah. So I want only 10 group ke 9 group kan, for this apa ni, this course eh. Okay. So ada soalan semua? Nurul, Yasmin, Absa, semua tak tunjukkan video eh. Buka lah video eh, I nampak muka you. Boleh I apa apa berinteraksi dengan you all eh. Okay, kalau tak ada, I will go to the outline eh of the study. Sekejap ya. Okay. Saya akan share outline of the study. Okay. Okay, nampak ya?
Nampak.
Okay, so this is our outline. First week, we're going to have introduction to Malaysian law. Introduction to health safety legislation. And then second week going to have talk about Occupational Safety and Health Act 1984 and also guideline sitting at work. So guideline sitting at work ni kita more on discussion eh, more on discussion. So I like you to read first before we going to do the class next week eh. So I will ask randomly any one of you regarding this guideline, and you all have to tell us what are this guideline for. Eh? Okay, so I already upload the guideline eh, in the week one. So you read when you going back, you read this guideline. Eh? Then next week, same time, after I give finish my lecture or before start lecture, you should present to us. Any one of you, I will pick up. Eh? Any one of you. Eh? So, second week, we're going to have OSHA Act 1994 and guideline sitting at work. And then the third week will be regarding health and safety regulation. Oh, ada yang belum masuk lagi. Dah. Ada yang join lambat ya. Saya pun tak faham kenapa you all join lambat. Ada kelas ke? Ada kelas lain ya? Okay. And then at fourth week, we're going to have health and safety officer regulation. And also guideline of working at display unit. And week five, we're going to have this use and standardized exposure chemical hazard to health regulation 2000. And week six, we have NADOPOT, notification of accident, dangerous occurrence, occupational poisoning and occupational disease regulation 2004, and guideline air quality of work. Then we have this Factory and Machinery Act 1967 and Factory and Machinery Lead. This is a regulation under the Factory and Machinery Act. They call it lead regulation. Eh? Then we're going to have guideline, local exhaust system. We're going to have noise exposure regulation, and also guideline occupation noise. Eh? And then we are going to have factory and machinery regulation, eh? Which is mineral dust regulation. And then guideline haze at work. Then regulation of asbestos, asbestos, and guideline working at confined space. Then during at 6 weeks, we're going to have test 20%. Eh? So the topic probably cover week 1 to week 5, right? And then at 12 week, we do have this Worker Compensation Act. Yeah. Siapa nak cakap tadi? Worker Compensation Act. And then guideline prevention of stress and violence at work. And then Occupation Act. Then there is a guideline gender at work. And last one, Perkeso Act. And at the end, it will be test 3, final 40%. Eh? And also we're going to find time for you all to present your assignment. Eh? So you have to work in group, eh? For this this subject. Eh? So this is the assessment. Test 1, 20%. Test 2, 20%. Test 3, final 40%. And assignment in group. Yeah. So, do you have any question regarding this outline? Anyone have problem? Okay, semua.
Okay, doktor. Okay.
Yeah. So, if you have question, please ask me right now. Regarding the syllabus and the outline. Since you all at home, you all pun belajar ambil OT intervention kan? In secretary. Ambil tak semester ni?
Belum lagi.
OT intervention in secretary.
OC. Belum.
Belum lagi eh? Eh, hey, kenapa you all?
Wasdik dah ambil semalam lepas.
Oh, dah ambil semalam lepas. Okay. Alright. So, kalau tak ada soalan, ada soalan tak tentang apa syllabus and outline ni?
So far tak ada lah,
doktor. I think you all semua ni ada 60 orang katnya. Dan tadi keluar masuk tadi ada 58. Eh? Okay, kalau tak ada soalan, I will present to you first topic kita. Yeah. Sebelum tu you all semua excited lah, eh? Or rasa macam mana? Seronok ke tak seronok? Sebabkan COVID ni terpaksa di rumah, eh? Duduk di rumah. Ya, yeah. Yasmin macam mana? Happy ke duduk di rumah? Tak happy. Yalah, sepatutnya pergi ke college kan. Seronok jumpa kawan-kawan, ada aktiviti. Kalau di rumah macam-macam cabaran. Environment, eh? Internet problem. And I hope that you all be okay lah your internet, eh. However, kalau you all terputus, I record every session tu. I record nanti I masukkan dalam YouTube. You all boleh tengok balik. Eh, sesiapa yang ada problem internet pula, ya. Saya faham kadang-kadang ada macam saya pun kalau guna mobile hotspot ataupun mobile punya internet very slow. Eh, kadang terkeluar, kadang masuk kan. So you kena preserve yourself lah menghadapi segala tekanan, ya. Okay. ada chat kan juga ni, ada yang chat juga ni. Ha, tak ada soalan. No, okay. Tutup nama doktor ke? Ha, nanti saya share lah. You just like je kan? Ha, like je eh. Nanti kita akan share eh. Lepas habis recording. Okay. Sekarang saya akan share topik untuk hari ni. So you all nampak tak?
Nampak.
Wahida memang suara Wahida je dengar. Lain tak dengar. Okay, Introduction of Malaysia Judiciary System. This is what is law. Anyone can give definition of law. This from Salman, bukan ikan Salman, Salman. The body of principle recognized and applied by the state in the administration of justice. Or the law consists of rules recognized and acted on the court of justice. So bila kes-kes jenayah atau kes-kes legal kan, mesti dibawa pergi ke mahkamah kan. So how judge interpret by apa, refer to the recognized principle, the body of principle recognized yang diluluskan oleh parlimen, law yang diluluskan. Judge tak boleh buat keputusan sendiri, tapi dia terpaksa melihat apa the principle that being recognized by our society, by our people. So this is the definition by Salman. So only in Malay by Austin, satu perintah dari suatu badan yang berkuasa untuk orang-orang biasa dan dikuatkuasakan hukuman. So there is a perintah, there is a rules. Then from the body that being that berkuasa kan, apa dia badan yang berkuasa di Malaysia ni ialah kerajaan Malaysia. Kerajaan Malaysia mempunyai peraturan dan undang-undang untuk kita semua, dan undang-undang dan tu dia ada hukuman, ada sanction, ada hukuman. Contoh macam kalau you tak pakai mask, apa hukumannya semasa COVID-19 ni kan? Hukumannya 1,000 denda. 1,000. Sebab tu semua sekarang ni tengok semua pakai mask kan? Dalam kereta pun pakai mask. Sebenarnya dalam kereta kalau seorang-seorang tak payah pakai mask kan? Kalau di public ni lah pakai mask. Ini tak. Dalam kereta pun pakai mask. So, satu perintah dari suatu badan yang berkuasa untuk orang-orang biasa dan dikuasakan dengan hukuman. There is a hukuman, there is a sanction need to be give. Kalau tak ada hukuman, orang tak akan, yang lain tak akan serik kan. Yang lain cakap, tak ada hukum pun, I buat jugalah. So must be a sanction. Kelson pula, hubungan antara satu peraturan dengan peraturan yang lain hingga tiba ke depan peraturan yang paling tinggi. So, ada peraturan, dia ada different peraturan. In Health and Safety Law Act, mesti ada peraturan, dia ada peraturan dan pelbagai peraturan. Tapi kita kena peraturan yang paling tinggi sekali. So, why law existed? Anyone can tell me why law existed? Wahida? Kenapa perlu peraturan undang-undang?
Supaya semua orang akan ikut peraturan.
Okay. Sofia? Sofia mana? Sofia senyap ke? Kenapa Sofia perlu ada law? Sofia tidur ke ni? Because there is too many hazards. We discuss related to industrial law lah. Law kena ada. Because in industry, there is too many hazards. Sebab kalau tak ada law stipulate hazard yang terdapat ni, akan membahaya, memberi ancaman bahaya kepada kita. There's too many hazard. What is hazard? Is a source of situation with potential for harm in terms of human injury or ill health, damage to property, environment or combination of this. So hazard dalam kehidupan kita, sekeliling kita ni banyak hazard. Hazard kan dalam safety hazard 4M. Ingat tu 4M. Apa tu? Material. Material macam chemical, machine, semua tu ada hazard. Media. Media talking about environment. Temperature, apa, udara, itu pun boleh menyebabkan hazard kepada kita. Cahaya matahari, ya, kalau terlebih hazard, it is a media. Man also can become a hazard. Kalau dia ada behavior yang suka buat shortcut, tak ikut peraturan, also become a hazard. Contoh, kalau dia dapat penyakit, kalau dia ada close contact dengan orang yang dapat COVID-19, dia buat tak tahu dia. Dia tak nak report, tak nak apa, menjalankan test. Dia akan memberi hazard pada orang lain. Kes tu akan berjangkit. Walaupun dia tak ada simptom, tapi dia carry the hazard, biological hazard. For man, media, machine and material. Machine pun boleh mendatangkan hazard. Media, kita punya apa, udara, kan, semua tu boleh memberi hazard. You tengok sini. Ini berlakunya kemalangan helikopter. Kemalangan helikopter, tempat dia berlabuh, dia ada kemalangan. Apa ni dia kemalangan? Tengok apa terjadi pada helikopter tu. Ini tumpahan minyak di lebuh raya. Pernah tak you experience tiba-tiba jam, tapi tak boleh langsung jalan? Pernah. Tak pernah?
Pernah.
Itu punya tumpahan chemical. Kan? Chemical. So ada regulation tentang packaging. Macam mana nak buat packaging yang betul dan sebagainya. Ini apa ni? Ini dia terlibat dengan kemalangan mesin. Dia buat apa ni, stamping. Dia apa ni, buat apa, stamping, dia buat apa, besi yang pressing ni. So tengah buat kerja tu, dia teringat girlfriend dia nama Wahidah. So dia dapat kemalangan di tempat kerja. So ataupun kebakaran di tempat kerja. Lagi. Ini apa dia ni? Nampak tak? Nampak semua?
Semen ni kan?
Ini batu empap orang yang kat bawah ni. Nampak ni? Penyek orang ni kat bawah. Batu tu, batu blok ni, dia mungkin dari segi susunan dia tak betul. Ada penghadang dia. Contoh yang berlaku baru-baru ni, ada empat proton tu kan. Ini dia empat orang pekerja. So industry, there's so many hazard. So because of this hazard, there must be a regulation and act. Kalau tidak, orang tidak akan ambil tahu. And then when people langgar dia apa ni undang-undang tu, dia boleh dikenakan hukuman. Majikan, pekerja, supervisor ke yang apa, melakukan kesalahan akan menerima hukuman. Ini apa ni? Nampak guys? Apa ni?
Tangan.
Dia masuk dalam mesin ni. Yang ni yang dia ingat girlfriend dia ni, Wahidah ni. Dia tengah kerja mesin ni yang proses apa ni? Proses meat kan, burger. Dia masuk tangan, termasuk tangan dia. Tengok macam ni. So case ni bila dah berlaku kemalangan, dia akan dapat amputation. So amputation refer to OT. But apa kesannya pada company dan sebagainya. So mesti ada peraturan dan undang-undang untuk mengelakkan kemalangan ni berlaku. So functions of the law is to control relation and social behavior, to act as a mechanism and procedures in settling confrontation. So ada confrontation. Kita kalau kadang kita bergaduh, tak perlulah bergaduh, bertekak, apa ni, bertumbuk. Kita pergi pergi mahkamah. Biasanya we see you in court. Itu untuk act as mechanism. Ialah tempat yang terakhir untuk mengatakan you bersalah atau tidak bersalah di mahkamah. To protect individual interest, to safeguard civil freedom, to declare and protect asset belonging, as a remedial provision for injuries and damage. So kadang-kadang kita nak elakkan kemalangan, but the accident happen, orang injured, damage, katakan rosak dia punya, terbakar dia punya kilang dan sebagainya. This is a way for remedial, ganti rugi, untuk kemalangan dan sebagainya. To ease social change. That's why ada undang-undang, contoh dalam keadaan COVID-19 kan, apa undang-undang dia, apa RU, apa undang-undang yang dipakai untuk apa ni, untuk ketenteraman awam. Mesti ada undang-undang. That's why ada PKP, PKPB, PKPP dan macam-macam PKP, macam-macam lah. This why untuk kita punya, untuk mengelakkan daripada huru-hara negara kita. That's why ada law. Okay, in Malaysia, in Malaysia system, the jurisdiction of the Malaysian court as a civil court, mahkamah umum, dia ada superior court dengan subordinate court. Apa dia, contoh kita tak payah tengok yang kat sini, yang kita tengok yang sini lah. Kita apa-apa mesti ada magistrate dulu. Dan mahkamah session court dan high court. Kalau kes tu lebih menyebabkan kes kejenayah yang tinggi, dia akan pergi kepada mahkamah tinggi. Contoh macam kes-kes yang dia punya jenayah dia melibatkan denda yang besar, denda yang tinggi, dia akan pergi ke High Court. Majlis Court ni yang melibatkan kes-kes kecil yang denda RM1,000, RM800, RM300. Pernah tak you pergi mahkamah Magistrate Court ni? Any one of you pernah pergi Magistrate Court?
Tak pernah.
Bukan you accident kemalangan yang raya kan? Contoh dia
kemalangan. Hulu Court tu macam mana?
Hulu Court ini ada apa ni, ini melibatkan Negeri Sembilan. Ini tak payah kita tengok. Kita tengok ini je. Biasanya dia akan pergi ke mahkamah magistrate. Katakan you kemalangan kereta. Okey, polis dapati you bersalah. You melanggar kereta tersebut. Dia saman you. You cakap, saya tak nak bayar saman, saya nak pergi mahkamah. So, mahkamah yang bicarakan you, mahkamah magistrate dulu. Mahkamah magistrate. Kalau you tak puas hati dengan mahkamah magistrate, you akan bawa ke mahkamah High Court. High Court. Biasanya sesi ni tak jarang-jarang dia bawa ke Session Court. Dia akan tu pergi kepada mahkamah tinggi. Kemudian you boleh bawa, kalau kes tu dia berarti you tak puas hati dengan apa ni, kes tu you akan bawa ke pergi kepada Court of Appeal, apa ni, mahkamah rayuan. Dan kalau you tak puas hati dengan hukuman ataupun you tak puas hati dengan apa, hukuman tersebut, you akan pergi kepada Federal Court, mahkamah persekutuan. So macam bekas Perdana Menteri kita, kan, bila dia bicara, dia tak pergi bicara kat sini. Dia terus pergi kepada High Court. High Court. Dan bila dia jatuh hukuman, dia bawa rayuan ke mahkamah rayuan. Bila mahkamah rayuan dia tak puas hati dengan hukuman tersebut, dia boleh buat rayuan ke mahkamah persekutuan, Federal Court. Special Court ni apa? Anyone can tell for this Special Court? Siapa yang boleh cakap? Sabrina? Apa tu? Special Court apa? You all kena bercakap juga lah.
Kalau orang tu gila.
Untuk Raja Raja.
Apa dia? Siapa tu? Syamimi?
Dos.
Special Court ni apa?
Special Court ni untuk keluarga diraja tu.
Yes, pandai. Dos. Special Court ni untuk Sultan Agong kan. Dia tak boleh pergi mahkamah apa ni, magistrate mahkamah tinggi, dia pergi ke Special Court. Special Court eh. So anyone in this Malaysia not above the law. Semua mesti ikut peraturan dan undang-undang. Nobody above the law. Nobody immune to the law. Even the Sultan. Sultan akan pergi kepada Special Court. So Special Court ni banyaklah. Ni tak payah kita bincangkan. Yang biasanya Special Court ni untuk Sultan. Bicara kepada Sultan. Ini contoh Federal Court. Contoh Federal Court. Federal Court ni pihak-pihak yang terlibat, Klebericus and Taz versus Tenaga Nasional Berhad. Keputusannya, permohonan ditolak dengan kos deposit kepada responden mengikut taksiran. Maksudnya dia dah pergi mahkamah tinggi dan dia pergi kepada ni sekarang mahkamah persekutuan. Ni lebih kepada dia ada saman, melibatkan saman dia saman Tenaga Nasional, mungkin ada kontrak ke dan sebagainya. So keputusan permohonan ditolak dengan kos deposit kepada responden mengikut taksiran kos. Okey, ini contoh-contoh kes ni. Hakim Federal Court ni 3 orang atau 5 orang. Ini yang melibatkan Federal Court. Khalid melawan Slim Darby. Kes dibatalkan tanpa apa-apa perintah terhadap kos. Dia lawan sampai ke Federal Court. Lembaga Jutera Malaysia versus Leong Tu Khan. Permohonan dibenarkan. Federal Court putuskan dibenarkan. Sebuah Raju Bonia versus Surajaya Perkhidmatan Awam. Permohonan dibenarkan. Ini contoh-contoh kes Federal Court. Di sini ada dua jenis. Nanti saya akan ceritakan lagi. Ini federal court. Nah, ini melibatkan 5 hakim. Hanafi bin Mat Hassan versus Pendawa Raya. Ini menyebab kes apa? Kriminal. Kriminal. So dia ada dua jenis undang-undang sini. Saya akan ceritakan lagi. Yang mana melibatkan jenayah. Yang kedua melibatkan compensation. So ini lebih kepada jenayah. So Pendawa Raya ini Government of Malaysia lah. Represent Government of Malaysia. So kes ni sampai ke Federal Court Mahkamah. Ini melibatkan nyawa. Mungkin dia punya sabit apa ni, hukuman dia hukuman gantung, mandatory. So rayuan ditolak, sabitan dan hukuman mahkamah tinggi dikekalkan. So Hanafi bin Mat Hassan melawan pendawa raya. So Malaysian of law, kalau kita tengok Malaysian law, there is two type of law. Three type of law. One is written law. Then another one is non-written law. Then there is another one, syariah law. So written law is something that been stipulated. This about criminal, jenayah. So di dalam tu ada akta dan sebagainya. Di mana akta ni dan aturan ni diluluskan di parlimen ataupun Dewan Undangan Negeri. Ini di talking about written law. Non-written law ni something melibatkan contoh tort law, contract law. It's a common law. They call it, they known as a common law. Common law ni macam you ada buat perjanjian and then you saman individu, saman apa majikan, mungkin dia ada apa perjanjian yang telah ditepati, dipanggil non-written law. And then there is a syariah law. Syariah law ni lebih kepada undang-undang Islam, berkaitan untuk orang-orang Islam. So remember, in Malaysia law, there is three type: written law, non-written law, and syariah law. Okay. Okay, ni tak payah. Okay, statutory law. Apa itu statutory law? Is undang-undang yang termaktub. Law that was enacted after 1956. Is formal written law of country of state. Kita dalam kerajaan persekutuan, kita ada akta. Itu dia panggil act. Di negeri macam negeri Selangor, dia ada enactment. So it's a formal written law of a country or state, written and enacted by its legislative authority, perhaps to then be ratified by the higher executive in the government. So dia ditulis oleh jabatan peguam negara, jabatan peguam negara, dan diluluskan oleh kabinet atau kementerian dan dibawa kepada Dewan Rakyat, dibentangkan dan diluluskan di dalam Dewan Rakyat dan kemudian dibawa kepada Dewan Negara. This is called written law. Written law known as statutory law. So this statutory law comprise of act and regulation. Typically statutes command, prohibit or declare policy. Statutes are sometimes referred to as legislation. This is legislation, statutory law. Then the thing of statutory law involve of penalties and imprisonment. Penalties can be compound, bayaran. Dia dah stipulate what are the maximum payment that judge can apa ni, can jatuhkan hukuman, and also involve imprisonment, penjara atau hukuman gantung sampai mati. This is a statutory law. So when talk about statutory law, ni dia. So kita akan baca acts and regulation. So our study right now in this course, we only study about law, industrial law, and health and social legislation. So for example, like Factory and Machinery Act 1967 and OSHA Act 1994. So this enactment is under the state. This ordinance is for apa, Sabah and Sarawak. So when talk about such a law, there is an act and enactment. So how the act been, how the enactment or the statutory law been imposed? So the things that the beginnings that our government will propose. Propose the act. Not act lah. They cannot not become an act unless it been approved by the royal assent. They can give proposal, and then they have a meeting with the relevant government authorities. Contoh macam Kementerian Kesihatan, Kementerian Kesihatan Malaysia, the government propose nak membuat apa ni, the draft bill apa, health and professional, untuk profession health and apa kesihatan, then dia buat meeting dengan NGO, dengan persatuan, relevant government authorities, then they draft dia punya bills by parliamentary jawatan peguam negara akan draft bill tersebut untuk dibentangkan di parlimen, then dibawa kepada kabinet, kabinet akan approve bill tersebut, dipanggil bill dulu, then they go to the Dewan Rakyat as a first reading, they first read dia punya bill tu. Dia akan bawa bacaan pertama, they call it short title read at the Dewan Rakyat. Then they have a second reading. The second reading will be a debate, dia punya principle, and there is a vote. Kalau disebab penting, kerajaan yang merentas sekarang mesti ada majority. Majority dalam dia punya in term of the numbers. Kalau tidak, susah benda tu dah buat kerja banyak-banyak kan, bila sampai ke Dewan Rakyat tak ada orang vote, rugilah. So biasanya kalau Dewan Rakyat tu perlukan numbers untuk vote, kalau dia tak ada orang yang vote lebih daripada apa ni, majority vote, dia tak boleh go to committee stage. So committee stage ni akan dibuat detail examination and amendments. Dia akan ada committee, dia akan tubuh committee yang akan menyemak secara detail dan membuat pembetulan amendments, then dibuat report to Dewan Rakyat. And then the next one is third reading. Third reading debate lagi, general principle and vote. Di sini vote yang kali kedua, dia bila dah lulus, dia datang kepada Dewan Negara. Dewan Negara pun akan melalui prosedur yang sama. Bila dah lulus, dan dia akan bawa kepada raja. Raja untuk diluluskan. Bila diluluskan, dia become, sorry, bill, become X. The bill become X. This is the process in term of statutory law, written law. This is the process. That's why very important for us to vote. Mesti ada kerajaan yang mempunyai majoriti yang besar. Kerajaan pemerintah mesti ada majoriti. Kalau tak ada majoriti, macam sekarang ni susah. Kadang-kadang nak, bila penat dah dia orang buat apa ni proposal, dia dah apa ni dah bertemu syarat dan sebagainya sampai masa nak sampai ke second reading ni tak lulus, tak cukup orang untuk vote. So tak lepas lah. Kadang-kadang ada written law yang perlu untuk masyarakat kita. Tapi bila ada masalah dari segi bilangan ahli Dewan Rakyat yang dia punya majoriti simple majoriti, kadang-kadang ada yang lompat, ada katak lompat dan sebagainya, ini is the problem. So dah ada sesiapa nak tanya, boleh tanya ataupun kita you comment, you tambah dan sebagainya, boleh juga ya. Jangan risau, tak ada masalah. Kita academic discussion. So, an act is a statute law made by parliament and enforced by the level relevant government and department responsible for the administration of the health and safety act in the state of territory. So, bila act tu telah diendorse oleh raja, department yang berkaitan akan enforcekan, akan melaksanakan act tersebut. Contoh macam yang kita akan belajar ni, Factory and Machinery Act, OSHA Act. Ini di bawah Department Safety and Health. Department Health and Safety, Department Safety and Health, DOSH, panggil DOSH. Ini semua di bawah DOSH. So di bawah DOSH ni, DOSH di bawah Kementerian Sumber Manusia. DOSH yang akan melaksanakan. So di sini akan cerita lebih lagi tentang regulation. Regulation, act and regulation apa beza dia? Act is like a mother, mother. So under the act, there is a regulation. Sebab act ni lebih kepada principle dia. Principle, dia punya spirit dan apa tu. And then the regulation is dia punya anak dia. Anak daripada act tu sebenarnya. So code of practice or guideline. So bila dia dah ada act, dia akan ada regulation dan juga guideline or code of practice. This code of practice support the act and regulation. So dalam code of practice or guideline, dia support akta tersebut. If a breach of a code is not by itself a breach of an act or regulation, however, code ni can be used as evidence in the court to demonstrate what employers should have been doing to ensure safe workplace. So, kalau dia bukan melanggar akta atau regulation, akta or regulation ni very dia stipulatkan dan dia punya limit dan sebagainya, dan tapi code of ethics ini boleh dibawa sebagai evidence untuk menceritakan employer ini buat tak something that follow the code of practice or guideline. Elements, laws enacted by state. Kalau state dipanggil enactments. Ordinance ni lebih kepada yang dulu, yang lama. Yang apa ni, Sabah, Sarawak, dia guna ordinance. Then there is another law, they call it common law. So there is two law, statutory law, and also there is a common law. Apa tu common law? Is the collection judgment made in previous cases until about 1957, law after arrival of British. Just and civil court decided case, they came to court and gave reason for their decision. Used when the absence of written law is compatible to situation. So kalau tak ada berkaitan dengan written law, dia dikenali sebagai common law. So enable the injured party to make claims against the defaulting party. Ini untuk claim kalau ada apa majikan yang menyebabkan kecederaan ataupun kecuaian, dia boleh gunakan common law. It has also been used to interpret many other laws and ruling that at time may have seemed ambiguous. Kalau undang-undang tu tak jelas, dia boleh digunakan common law. Dia melibatkan kes-kes tadi yang lampau. However, the common and such laws cover and protect different dimension of cases upon conviction, monetary compensation. So dalam common law ni, dia punya conviction kalau didapati bersalah, dia tak ada imprisonment. Dia tak ada punishment. Dia melibatkan compensation, monetary, melibatkan duit, compensation, duit. Common law ni ada banyak jenis. There is a tort law, contract law. Ini ordinary ni biasanya tak ada lah. Melibatkan dua ni. So you kena faham dua ni. Tort law. Tort law yang melibat kacau ganggu, kecuaian, fitnah. Contoh macam Atifah fitnah Nur Fasha dalam Facebook, kan? So Nur Fasha boleh pergi mahkamah untuk saman Atifah kerana mencemarkan image dia dalam Facebook. So this is, they call it tort law. So the remedy of the common law is compensation. Dia tak boleh penjarakan Atifah, tapi dia boleh minta pampasan dari segi duit, kan? So negligent, kecuaian. Nah, kadang-kadang ada majikan dia tak ikut SOP, dia tak ikut garis panduan dia safety and health, keselamatan dan kesihatan. Contoh dia dia tak ada, dia tak bagi safety shoe, dia tak bagi, katakan contoh di UiTM, katakan contoh dia hire contract sub worker, contract company untuk pembersihan. Bila buat pembersihan tak ada sign, yang apa ni tempat jalan kaki tu licin dan berbahaya. Dia tak ada label sebagainya. Then you all jalan kat situ. Contohnya macam Atifah berjalan situ, tiba-tiba jatuh. Jatuh, mengalami kecederaan hingga menyebabkan paralyzed, lumpuh separuh badan. Jadi paraplegia pula. So you boleh saman UiTM dan and that company sebab cuai, tidak menjalankan tanggungjawab untuk menjaga keselamatan dan kebajikan pelajar. This why then you saman, you mohon lah dan mahkamah, you mohon ganti rugi pendapatan, ganti rugi rawatan dan pemulihan, ganti rugi membeli kursi roda dan sebagainya. So dia saman UiTM dan juga company tersebut yang buat pembersihan tu. This is the definition of the tort law. Tort ni, a word originate from Latin. they call tortoise. It means twisted or wrong. Tort refers to the body of the law which will allow an injured person to obtain compensation from the person who caused the injury. Contoh macam Fidaus dengan Hakim. Hakim bergaduh, kan? Tumbuk sampai apa ni? Tercabut gigi, mata buta, eh? So Hakim boleh saman Fidaus, eh? Menyebabkan kejeraan, eh? Dia dah bagi dapat pampasan, eh? So tort refers to the body of the law which allow an injured person to obtain compensation from the person who caused the injury. Compensation is probably the most important social rule of tort law. Example, punch nose. Tumbuk sampai patah hidung orang tu. General features of a tort: there must be a wrongful or unauthorized act or omission. Dia mesti, dia dapat buktikan, dapat tunjuk buktikan orang tu apa, cuai, bersalah, yang tak ikut peraturan dan sebagainya. There must be a wrongful of or authorized act or omission affect the interest of right of others. The injured party of victim has right to claim for damage. So this dia guna undang-undang orang yang injured, victim yang injured boleh claim damage. Duty of care under common law: employers are not exempted from responsibility under duty of care even though he has assigned a competent person to execute the task. Bila dia, walaupun dia dah hire pegawai, safety health officer, tapi dia tak boleh lari daripada tanggungjawab untuk memastikan duty of care, maksud penjagaan yang sepatutnya pada orang yang dia bertanggungjawab. So Wilson, contoh di bawah ni, Wilson and Clyde Cole versus English Mark Jusso versus Syarikat Jaya Seberang Takir Senyum Bahad. Mungkin Mark Jusso ni dah ataupun Wilson and Cycle versus English, dia ni walaupun dia cakap dia dah ada orang yang apa, yang bertanggungjawab menjaga keselamatan dan kesihatan, tapi dia dapati cuai dari segi yang lain-lain, dia boleh didakwa dan diminta pampasan. So employer's liability under the duty of care, type of injuries, injuries of individual employees. Injuries on individual employees, boleh kita buat pergi mahkamah, kita boleh apa ni, dakwa majikan, employees. Injured caused by one worker to another worker or negligence by an agent who undertakes the task of behalf of the employer. Maksudnya, even kalau dia hire orang luar, subcontractor bekerja di tempat dia, dia tak boleh lepas tanggungjawab. Kalau dia menyebabkan kecederaan pada pekerja, atau pekerja pada pekerja pun boleh diambil, boleh dibawa ke common law, mahkamah common law, mahkamah awam. So employer's liability under the duty of care: employers are however not responsible for any action by the worker which do not fall within the scope of job such as cosplay while at work. So ni case pula, dia Smith ni, dia melawan Crossley Brothers Limited. Dia bawa pergi mahkamah nak minta papasan, tapi mahkamah dapati bahawa Smith ni dia buat apa, dia ada behavior cosplay. Cosplay ni maksudnya dia kerja main-main, dia tak ikut peraturan, tapi dia nak minta papasan. So mahkamah dapati employers tak bertanggungjawab, sebab Smith ni tak ikut peraturan ataupun SOP. Dia main-main dalam buat kerja dia. Eh? So, dia apa, employees tak liable. Liable. So, not responsible for any action by the worker which do not fall within the scope of his job. Eh? Dia tak ikut scope job dia, dia main-main. Eh? Cosplay. Eh? Kadang-kadang tak, tak dapatlah dia minta papasan. Eh? Sebab dia tak ikut scope kerja dia. Ini yang ni tak payahlah kita tahu. Yang penting kita tahu common law, tort law, apa dia? Tort law and contract law. Eh, contract law ni ibarat macam you bekerja, katakan besok nanti you bekerja, ada perjanjian bila dilantik, eh, you dapat ada ada tertulis di situ. You tak boleh berhenti kerja dan sebagainya. Itu akan cerita lain. Eh? Itu apa, Occupation Act. Eh, nanti akan cerita lagi lecture yang lain. Eh. So, element to associate case of negligence against the employer, evidence of duty care by one party, the employer on the other part, the employee. So, you kena, apa, kalau kita nak dakwa seorang tu negligent, mesti ada tunjukkan bukti bahawa dia bertanggungjawab. Dia ada tanggungjawab untuk menjaga pada pekerja tu. Evidence of duty of care by one party on the other party. You kena buktikan yang dia bertanggungjawab pada pekerja tersebut. Majikan tu bertanggungjawab. Evidence of violation of the responsibility. Dia you kena evidence dia tidak apa violate responsibility sebagai employer duty of care, dia melanggar ataupun dia tidak melakukan tanggungjawab sebagai majikan. Violation of the responsibility which causing damage injury. So you kena tunjukkan evidence dia tidak menjalankan tanggungjawabnya menyebabkan kemalangan apa kemalangan kecederaan atau damage is that apa dia panggil damage ni apa ya damage dalam bahasa Malaysia kerosakan ya kerosakan kerosakan pada machine anda sebagainya so this is where you want to bring just apa this thing to the court you must have evidence. Evidence of duty of care, evidence of violation, and evidence of apa violation of responsibility that cause damage and injuries. Mesti ada damage dan injuries, kerosakan ataupun kecederaan. Barulah boleh buat pergi ke apa ni ke mahkamah. Contoh, kalau contoh Nur Fasha dengan Nik ni dia buat apa ni sama apa ni dia buat fitnah di Facebook pada Nik katakan tapi Nik mesti buktikan ada damage injuries right now injuries of for example like psychological affected distress you got depression also can be take into account kalau you are dalam keadaan depressed tak boleh bekerja disebabkan oleh you dah apa telah damage you punya reputation di Facebook dan sebagainya itu boleh dijadikan bukti tapi kena tunjukkanlah you masuk hospital sakit jiwa dan sebagainya it's not easy mesti ada evidence so in this course we going to have industrial legislation punya and talk about industrial legislation it can be industrial safety, employment, industrial relation, well, employee social and welfare, workers compensation, and then environment punya act. So this is the thing that relate to the industrial legislation. Okay. Ini nanti you baca sendiri lah. Ini sebenarnya tak banyak yang relate sangat. Okay. Okay, ada soalan tentang topik ini? Okay, kelas, ada soalan tentang topik yang kita dah bincangkan tadi? Introduction block. So, law di Malaysia ni ada berapa jenis? Senyap dia semua?
Tiga.
Apa dia? Apa Nurul?
Written law.
Written law.
Non-written law.
Non-written law. Syariah. Yes, very good. Differentiate between written law and non-written law. Nurul?
Non-written untuk criminal. Written law untuk criminal. Non-written law untuk macam ada penjanjian ataupun kita nak saman majikan.
Yeah. Okay, good. So, statutory law or written law is similar again. Common law, the difference between statutory law and common law is that statutory law is being, there is a law written, written law. Written law that been...
Ada akta.
Ada akta. How the law being, developed? How the law been developed? Macam mana law tu been developed?
Bill. Draft bill.
Apa dia? Siapa yang cakap ni? So law, a written law developed by responsible ministry. Betul tak? Sebelum dia buat law tu, dia buat proposal dulu untuk keperluan masyarakat lah, kan? Kemudian dihantar kepada Jabatan Peguam Negara, dia draftkan bill tersebut. Selepas dia draftkan, approved by cabinet, so dia akan bawa masuk ke dalam Dewan Rakyat.
Dewan Rakyat.
First reading, then second reading, then dia vote, kan? Then there is a third reading, and there ada committee punya stage, then dia vote for the third reading. Lepas dia vote third reading, dia bawa pergi ke Dewan Negara. Dewan Negara akan bawa benda tu ke Dewan Negara, mulai proses yang sama. Kemudian dah lulus Dewan Negara, barulah Royal punya approval. Barulah dia jadi Akta, Act. Bukan senang proses dia tu, ambil masa. Macam Professional Allied Health Act tu, masa saya sekolah dulu. Masa saya belajar di college dulu. Ni dah berapa tahun saya kerja? 30 tahun. 34 tahun dah barulah lulus. Macam-macam problem. Kalau kita ada akta, akta profession, kita punya akta recognized as professional. Professional. Besok dalam akta apa, dia akan tubuhkan council. You kena register kan. You kena ada license untuk practice. Kalau you tak ada license, macam safety health officer ni, dia ada license untuk practice. Macam you besok, kena ada license untuk practice. You kena renew. So, siapa-siapa tak boleh claim sebagai OT. So, it's good lah. It's good that you're sometimes, kadang-kadang cikgu PDK, cikgu pun dia belajar sikit, ajar kat dia OT. Mana boleh kan? Kita dah belajar 4 tahun pergi training, tiba-tiba dia belajar 2 minggu, dapat certification apa dah, dia claim dia sebagai OT. Mana boleh? Kita boleh saman dia. Kita boleh saman dia sebab ada written law kat situ untuk register sebagai OT. Eh? Kalau talk about tort law, what is tort law? Apa tort law tu? Anyone?
Law kalau ada gangguan, trespassing.
Ada.
Something civil.
Trespassing, negligence,
defamation,
kan? Lagi apa? So you kena provide evidence, duty of care, kan? And then you kena provide evidence there is damage or injuries. Contoh macam you tarnish atau defame dia dekat Facebook. Reputation dia tercemar. Kan? Dia tak boleh. Katakan you tarnish, katakan you do, apa in future you buat klinik Nurul, katakan klinik Cahaya Nurul, klinik Nurul, eh, so ada pula orang tarnish, damage you punya reputation tu dekat Facebook, dekat Nurul ni tak profesional, dah mula dulu dapat ramai pesakit, tiba-tiba tak dapat sakit. Dia dah defame you, kan? Reputation you dah. So you boleh, you kena provide evidence lah. Evidence Facebook dia tanding macam mana, you punya pendapatan you dah berkurangan, case dah tak ada, you pun dapat kurang, company you dapat apa, pendapatan kurang, eh? You boleh bawa pergi mahkamah. Tort law, eh? Tort law, this goes to common law. So you boleh minta compensation in term of monetary. So the difference between common law and common law and statutory law is that dia punya if convicted, katakan statutory law ni boleh melibatkan imprisonment, boleh dipunish dengan denda duit, compound dan juga penjara. Tapi common law ni hanya compensation of money. Tapi you kena provide evidence. Ya. Yeah? Okay. Yang lain ada soalan?
Tak ada.
Tak ada. Safa tak ada, eh? So kita akan belajar act and regulation and also guideline and code of ethics that relate to the health, safety and also industry. Itu sebab kita belajar Factory Machinery Act, OSHA Act, Occupation Act, Compensation Act that relate to the worker, while they're working. Itu sebab apa? Bila kita sebagai OT, kita akan buat work visit. So bila buat work visit ni, you understand the act and the regulation about when they will go to work, kan? So you tahu limit in term of regulation, limit apa chemical exposure, noise. So you can consult the employer, regarding the punya hazard, eh? So this is the advantage, when you study this act and regulation, eh? Okay, ada soalan lagi? Minum air dulu, minum air. Okay, dalam week 1 punya folder, I dah uploadkan guideline for sitting at work. Eh? So, you all baca nota saya at the same time, baca the guideline. For example, before start class, we ask any one of you explain about the guideline. Eh? So this guideline of sitting, for example, when we do work with it when we when the workers have injuries, for example, they are the back apa back pain due to the punya sitting position. So you can recommend. So you identify the problem, the issue. For example, patient complain got back pain ataupun discomfort dekat dia punya back tu. Then you buat work visit, then you identify this is the risk while they work in prolonged time, okay? So when you got the guideline already, a guideline of sitting posture, dia punya monitor, where are the monitor should be. So with this guideline, you are able to recommend to the worker. Or you become consultant to industry. For example, you want to embark in ergonomics ke, in industry. So we have graduate, we have alumni. For example, apa nama dia? Amar. Dia ni consultant, PIPIT. Dia panggil PIPIT consultant. Ergonomics. Dia ada pengalaman kerja di UK. Dia buat master, dia apa, continue his study master in ergonomics. So dia ada consultant company right now in Malaysia. So whatever relate to the workers punya workstation job, he consult to the industry. And so he also doing training. Education training to the worker. So remember your career not only at working at an hospital, but also you can embark with apa ni, with industry, social security organization, SOCSO, for apa becoming apa ni. When you graduate, last time I think there is a video, graduate OT become manager, deputy director for what company? Dia macam buat dia bagi engineering, dia buat. Company itu supply sub company yang supply accessories to the apa ni to the manufacturing car. You see, not necessary working at hospital. OT can go beyond that. With your knowledge and with your skill, with your brilliant, I know you all. Brilliant, educated, highly. I know you all punya SPM background or that. You are very intellectual people. The only thing is to furnish yourself dengan skill communication and then personality. Improve your personality to be in the competitive employment. Okey, ada soalan? Nurul, ada? Assignment tu nanti saya akan bagi lagi butir-butirnya. The information about assignment tu nanti saya akan bagi. Ada apa-apa yang nak tanya, Fidaus? Okey semua?
Tadi, sir.
Tak ada? Okay. Yang lain kalau tak ada, okey, saya punya lecture. Satu setengah jam. Sebenarnya sejam itu baru kita break. Tapi saya terus. Okay. Untuk first week ni, cukup sampai sini. Kita akan bertemu lagi next week. So please read the guideline. Okay. So thank you very much. See you all next week. Okay. stay home, stay safe, and preserve yourself. Alright? Okay, bye.